It's been a long time since I've preached, so I hope you're ready for this. I did get to preach in Rome, so I did have that experience. They also discovered what it's like when I haven't preached for a while as well. So let's jump into this idea of looking at promises. For the 6 weeks that I've been away, you've been exploring this theme of promises, and I don't know. Promise is a bit of a loaded word, isn't it? In today's world, we've got a bit skeptical of promises. Like if a politician makes a promise, you know, that's the skepticism I'm talking about. And unfortunately, that's drifted through our way of looking at promises a bit. And maybe some of us have been burned badly by broken promises at different times. And maybe for some of us, that's even led to a bit of, you know, trust issues. And so, you know, this idea of promises is not the greatest thing to look at in the context of today's world. And yet, promises is a mega theme in the Bible. It's something that the Bible focuses on a lot. God is described as a promise keeper. We believe in a God who is faithful and always keeps his promises. God promised to never flood the world again after Noah. God promised to lead the Israelites into the promised land, and God promised to send us a savior. And God did all these things and more. There's lots of promises in the Bible that God fulfilled. Psalm 145:13 reminds us that God is trustworthy in all God promises and is faithful in all God does. We believe that, don't we? Yeah. The Bible takes this idea of promises a step further and actually talks about this word covenant. Covenant. And a covenant is a deeply significant or personal promise, a contract between people or communities that is significant. A covenant outlines the understanding of the promise and the conditions and the expectations on each side of that promise, for that promise to be kept. For us, probably the most familiar biblical example of a covenant is marriage. Because, like, marriage is more than just promises, aren't they? Like, we make promises in marriage, but it's more than that. It's more than that. It's a commitment to spend a life together, to be faithful, to be always there for each other, to love and support. Can you see the difference between a promise and a covenant? And so when it comes to promises, the Bible talks about God making a covenant with us. That God will be our God and we will be God's people. Over the past 6 weeks, you've been looking at some examples of these covenants between God and people. The covenant between God and Abraham, where God said that he will bless Abraham and all his descendants. The covenant between God and Moses and the people of Israel, where God led them out of slavery in Egypt and guided them through the giving of the law. And that was part of that covenant arrangement. And so in our reading from 2 Samuel chapter 7, we get what we call the Davidic covenant, God's promise to David to establish an ongoing house or throne or kingdom to be ruled by his ancestors, and that David's name will be great forever. So let's just have a closer look at David. When Michelangelo made his famous statue of David, it was described as the greatest statue ever. And he chose David as his subject. I just happened to see David on my recent holiday. Get used to it. You're going to get a lot of stories from holidays over the next 6 months. So here is me with David in Florence as we went and visited David. Has anyone else visited David? It's huge, isn't it? Like, you don't imagine it to be, you know, this 4 meter tall statue. It's been called the greatest statue ever created because it's perfectly made. Apparently, Michelangelo took anatomy classes so he could understand how the body worked and how the muscles worked and how you know, everything fitted together so that when he carved this piece of rock, he could make it as realistic as he could, anatomically correct. And while this statue might be perfect, as John already acknowledged in his kids' talk, David was not. David was not. I was supposed to talk about it. If you're close to David and look at it, you can actually see right down to the veins underneath the skin and all that sort of stuff. It really is an extraordinary piece of work. That's where I'm up to. David's statue might be perfect, but David the person was not. David was a flawed person who made some really poor decisions, as we've already acknowledged. When we first meet David, he's just a lowly shepherd who was selected by God and anointed to be the next king of Israel. And David showed some amazing faith as he trusted in God and standing up and defeating Goliath with some rocks. And he became king and reigned for the next 40 years, was the king of Israel. And it was regarded to be basically the high point of the kings of Israel with David. And yet, as I said, David was a flawed person. He was a person who actions included lying and deceiving and adultery and murder. Like, he was a flawed person. One thing that David had going for him, and Quibby's already mentioned it today, that he was a person after God's own heart. Time and time again, when David failed, he would repent and turn back to God. And we can read many expressions of David's lament and, you know, calling upon God's mercy through the Psalms. So we have this complex picture of David as a person who is faithful and trusting and yet flawed and making mistakes. So how do we understand this passage that we read about the promises that God made to David? So let's just step through this passage and see what emerges. Our reading starts with the king wanting to build a house for the Ark of the Covenant. David is flying high in his kingship at this point. He had conquered most of his enemies by this point. He has built an impressive palace in Jerusalem, and he has brought back the Ark of the Covenant to Jerusalem. All these have happened just in the previous chapters. So things are going really good for David. And so David goes, well, what's next? What's next? And so he decides if he as a king is living in an impressive house, then surely the Ark of the Covenant should have an impressive house as well. Just on the side, while we were in Rome, we did see some impressive houses that were built for God. I don't know if anyone else has been in Rome and seen some of these buildings, but oh my, they are just incredible. And whilst I struggled a little bit with some of the excessiveness that comes through in some of these pictures, I do get what they're trying to do, to create a space that gives glory to God, that helps people, a lot of people back then who couldn't read or engage with the written text of the Bible, and experience the story and the presence of God in these amazing places. I sort of get that. And so, you know, it's a similar sort of thinking that David had, isn't it? To sort of go, well, I've got an impressive palace. Surely God deserves an impressive house as well. Surely I should be building a place for the Ark of the Covenant. And in response to that, the prophet Nathan says, basically, whatever you have in mind, go ahead and do it, because the Lord is with you. The Lord is with you. This is the first time we actually meet Nathan. Up to this point, there's been another major prophet that's been dealing with David up to this point. Do you know who that prophet is? Samuel. Samuel was the major prophet for all of David's life. Samuel was the one who anointed David initially and was the one who helped David through the early parts of his kingship. But Samuel had died. And so God needed another prophet to be speaking to David, and Nathan is the one who gets the calling. And so this is the first time we get to meet Nathan. And so here's Nathan standing before this great, amazing king, David, who's just done all these amazing stuff. And you could just imagine Nathan for the first time, what's this going to be like? And he stands before David, and David says, I want to build God a great house. And rather doing what most prophets should do at this point, go and ask God, what do you want me to say back to David? Nathan just goes, do whatever you like, because God is obviously with you, so just do whatever you like. But that night, God actually comes to Nathan and says, this is what I want you to tell David. You know, you should have asked me first, but this is what I want you to tell David. And says, you know, as a prophet, you're supposed to speak for me, so go and ask David why he thinks I need a house and why he thinks that he should be the one to build me a house. God says, I never asked for one. Why are you even thinking this? I need to pause here just for a moment and give you an interesting tidbit about this passage. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, the word house is mentioned 13 times. And in English, we use the word house for each of those 13 times. But in the Hebrew, there's a lot more subtleness about what it's talking about when it mentions the word house. And it's just worth just highlighting this as we are working through this passage. So, for example, in verse 1, when David speaks about building a house of cedar, what have I just done? Have I skipped over the... I've just jumped out of my sermon there. But in verse 1, when we talk about the house of cedar, he's referring to his palace. David's referring to his palace. But when they're talking about a house for God, they're referring to a temple. Not a palace, but a temple. In verse 11, when God is saying that the Lord will establish a house for David, it's not talking about either palace or a temple, but more like this legacy, this ongoing connection where David's ancestors will rule as king. In verse 13, it hints that the house of God is a kingdom. Whether that's talking about David's kingdom or the kingdom of God, you could read it both ways. And if we skip down to verse 25, 26, and 29, which is not part of our reading, but still in the same chapter, it talks about God making promises to the house of David, which is a metaphor for the people of Israel, or even you could read that to all people of God, which includes us. So it's interesting, isn't it, that they all mention just the word house as we move through. And I think we just need to have this in the back of our mind as we continue to work through this passage, just to sort of go, well, you know, which is it referring to as we see this word house popping up? I think it's also important because sometimes when we look at this and go, is this God making a covenant with David as a person, or David's ancestors, or the people of Israel, or all of us? I actually think it's all of the above. All right, let's jump back in. So David says, I want to build a house, and God says, you're missing the point here. You know, I've never had a house up to this point. I've always been a God who's been in the place where the people are. And so when the people were moving around in the desert, the tabernacle moved with them. God's saying, I've always been somebody who's just been where the people are. I don't quite understand why you need to build me a house. And besides, why do you think that you are the one to build a house? And then God goes on to remind David that actually, if you're trying to think that you can do this for me, you need to realize that it's actually the other way around. I do stuff for you. Without me, you're nothing. You know, I'm the one who appointed you. I'm the one who defeated your enemies. I'm the one who does the nice things or blesses you. Not the other way around. And then instead of just leaving it there, God goes a step further and says, and speaking of blessing, this is what I promise. And then rattles off a number of promises to David in this passage. He says that he will continue to bless David by making his name great, establishing a home for Israel, keeping the people from oppression, giving David a rest from his enemies, establishing a house for David's descendants, allowing David's son to build the temple, and promising to always be there and love David and his descendants forever. So this is why we're talking about promises. This is why this passage was chosen, because these are the promises that God gave to David, or through David to all of us. And then to conclude this list of promises, God adds one on the end, which is actually, we suggest, is not part of the Davidic covenant, but the Messianic covenant, because God promises to establish a kingdom in the line of David that will endure forever. And our understanding of that is that he's referring to Jesus at that point, which John already mentioned in his kids' talk. Well, two things here. Firstly, did God keep all those promises? It depends how you read them. You know, David's ancestors are going to rule forever. David's son, Solomon, was king. Solomon's son was king, and then it all sort of fell apart. And then his direct line was not part of the kingly establishment anymore. So his ancestors didn't really rule forever. But it depends how we understand it. If we understand it in the messianic line, yes, Jesus, who was in the line of David, is the greatest king who rules forever. So it depends how you understand these things. But the real question that I want to just explore with just in the last few minutes is, but what does this mean for us as a church? You know, this is fine for David and the people back then. But why are we reading a passage like this? Why have we just spent the last 6 weeks looking at promises? What is the good news for us out of this? Well, the obvious answer is the good news of Jesus, of which we're just about to go on looking at our next series about. You know, the links between the Old Testament prophecies and Jesus. Those threads are woven together. God's promise to David to always love and be there for his family is not only referring to his ancestors, but referring to all people of God, including us. We live within the kingdom of Jesus that is promised in verse 16. That is the good news for us. But I want to pick up on just one other point, which I think is good for us as well. One of the interesting aspects of the Davidic covenant, which is different from something like, say, the Mosaic covenant, the promises that God gave to Moses, is that they're unconditional. That God doesn't place any conditions on David when he gives all these promises. When Kevin preached on the Mosaic covenant, the promises given by God to Moses and the people of Israel at that time, you may have noticed that they were conditional. So when God gave the promises there, it was a bit like, you know, all these blessings will come to you and accompany you if you follow my commandments, if you obey the Lord your God. There's numerous verses in all of that that say the same thing. Here are the commandments. Here are the laws. If you follow these, you will be blessed. If you don't follow these, well, then yeah, you're on your own, and whatever life happens. And so you have this idea that they are conditional promises. And yet when it comes to David, it's intriguing that God doesn't place any conditions on these at all. God doesn't say, I will do this if you keep your law, or if you love me, I will do this. But rather, it's this idea that he simply explains that these promises rest entirely on God's grace and mercy and love and faithfulness, not on whether David is faithful, not what David does or does not do for God, which is probably pretty good for David because of the ups and downs of David's lives. When David offers to build a house for God, God says, you're missing the point here. It's not about what you need to do to receive my blessing. It's about you just receiving my blessing. I will keep these promises to you regardless of what you do for me. Does this sort of idea sound familiar? Because it's what we preach all the time. It's exactly what we read in Ephesians chapter 2, which says, you know, it's by grace that we have been saved through faith. It's not from anything that we do. It's a gift from God. You know, it's almost like God's saying, I don't want you to build me a house, David, because you will boast about it. You will say, I am the one who built this magnificent house for God. God's going, it's not about that. I want you to realize that it's about me and what I do for you. God makes the same point to Abraham in the covenant that God makes in Genesis 15. I don't know if you heard this story when you looked at Abraham when I was away, but when they're doing the covenant with Abraham, God, back then, what you do if you're making a covenant with each other, you get some animals and sacrifice them and split them in half, and you'd both walk down between the animals. I know it sounds weird, but that's what they did. And in doing so, you're both making a commitment to keep that promise. And so when God is making the promise with Abraham, the commitment, they do this. They get the animals, they split them in part, but then God makes Abraham fall asleep. And God, as represented by a flame, walks down between the animals by God's self. What's the symbolism of that? God's saying, when it comes to this, keeping this promise, it's not up to you. It's only up to me. And I will keep my promises because I'm a promise keeper. Do you see the symbolism, the powerful symbolism of that? It's the same with David. That God is saying to David, it is dependent upon me, not upon you, these promises being kept. So for David, the fact that God's promises were unconditional, as I said before, was perfect because in David's life, he was not perfect. And so, you know, it didn't matter that David let God down every now and again. God was always there and kept the promises for David. And we too are recipients of God's unconditional promises. There are too many promises to mention in Scripture. I was going to copy them all out and post them on Facebook for you, but you can go to your own Bible. But here's 10 quickly so you can see what God promises to us. God promises to strengthen you, to give you rest, to provide for your needs, to respond to your prayers, to work for good in your lives. God promises to always be there for you, to support you in difficult times, to always forgive you. God promises that nothing will ever separate us from God's love for us, and God promises us abundant and eternal life. That's just a small sample of the promises of God in Scripture. And just like David, all of those promises are unconditional. God just says, these are for you. These are for you. And I will keep those promises regardless of who you are, what you've done, what you're doing, what you will do, because I am a promise keeper. All we have to do in response is to live our lives in gratitude for all that God has done, reflecting that same love, grace, and generosity that God has given us to the people around us. We can do that, can't we? Amen.